The English are making a sneak attack!
Hey everyone, JRed here, and welcome to yet another Deathmatch Civilization Overview. Today, we will be going over a civilization that was very highly requested for me to look at, which is the Britons. They're a very popular and very well-known civilization in Age of Empires 2, because they were the main antagonists of some very important campaigns, and because their unique unit, the Elite Longbowmen, is famous for its incredible range. They're a very long-ranged civilization, with archers that have extra range and some of the best superior siege weapons. However, are these attributes enough to make them a good deathmatch civilization? Well, let's find out. To start off, the first Briton bonus is that town centers cost minus 50% wood. In other words, they cost only 150 wood instead of 300. This can be very helpful in a standard random map game because it improves your boom, making it easier to create extra TCs to make more villagers. In Deathmatch though, the savings are only about 1050 wood for 7 town centers, which is about 5% of your starting stockpile, so it's really not that significant. Next, shepherds work 25% faster. Again, it's helpful in random map because it makes your Dark Age villagers better, but it's not really applicable for deathmatch. Moving on to the military bonuses, foot archers but not skirmishers have +2 range in the Imperial Age, and when combined with the Yeoman unique technology, it's +3 in total. This gives arbalests 11 range instead of a generic civilization's 8. This makes them get more shots off and far easier to micro because you have a lot more space to work with. They still get countered by the same units, in my opinion, but they can deal a lot more damage because they get more shots off and because it's far easier to keep them safe. Also relatedly, this Yeoman unique technology gives towers +2 attack. Now, I don't really know about random map, but towers are not that useful in deathmatch and still definitely not as good as bombard towers. However, in games where bombard towers are banned, keeps can be nice defensive structures because you can place them on hills, but they don't take up nearly as much space as castles, and therefore units don't really path around them as much, and they are created a lot faster, so they're better than castles in some situations at quickly securing ground that has already been captured. This bonus makes them better against high pierce armor units such as paladins, and therefore, in my opinion, it makes them far better than a normal tower because they'll be a lot more effective. Moving on, their unique unit is the Longbowman. The elite version is basically an arbalest with slightly higher wood cost but lower gold cost, and it's statistically superior. It works well as a support unit to deal damage to enemies at range, and it can protect your siege and infantry fairly well. While I've already looked at a comparison between this unit and the Briton arbalests in a previous video, one important thing to remember is that the Britons actually lack thumb ring, and as such, the Longbowmen and the arbalests really are not as accurate as you might expect them to be. When looking at the difference between these units, I think the most important one is that arbalests are created from archery ranges, making it much easier to field them in deathmatch. This means that if I gain an early advantage with arbalests and I think I can win the game in this early stages of it, I'll probably still make them just to get more units onto the field. However, longbows have more range and attack, so it's better to make them once you get castles out, and as such, creating castles should be a priority for the Britons. Speaking about castles, they're also very important because you can make trebuchets from them. The Briton unique technology Warwolf gives Trebs blast damage. This means that when a 90kg projectile hits a target that may be up to 300 meters away, not only the target is damaged, but also the surrounding units are. Now, while the Trebuchet's new blast radius is only one tile, normal superior siege weapons only deal damage to one unit hit, so the Briton Trebs can definitely sabotage a large number of enemy units when used correctly. If we modify the champions to have extra HP, we can see that this blast damage deals between 180 and 150 damage, which is enough to kill most units in just one hit. Looking at a real combat situation, however, you have to keep in mind that this technology gives trebuchets a 100% accuracy. So, unfortunately, you don't get the benefit of an area barrage, it's more like a super high-powered strike at one point. Remember, trebuchets cost 200 wood and 200 gold, as opposed to the 160 wood and 135 gold for an onager, so you have to remember that they are very expensive, very immobile, and they oftentimes miss their units, and as such can be very fragile. In my opinion, it's really just a gimmick. Sure, if you have Trebs set up, you can definitely destroy large portions of the enemy army, and you should try to do so. However, you have to individually micro the trebuchets, and it's risky. Ironically though, it works well versus archers, and particularly so versus one certain long-ranged archer sieve. And finally, their team bonus is that archery ranges work 20% faster. It's very nice to get arbalests out in 17 seconds instead of 20, but in reality it's not as powerful as you might think it is, because in an early game deathmatch, Britons have neither strong heavy cavalry archers nor treadmill crane, so you really can't use this to get large portions of deadly archer units out like the Huns or another civ can. It is definitely helpful, but it's not as powerful as some people unfamiliar with deathmatch might make it out to be. And so, as you can tell, the majority of these bonuses really affect the Britons' long-range units. You might think that their archers would therefore be overpowered, and also that they would be a very strong deathmatch civilization. However, let's look at their tech tree to really see how strong they are. To start off, in a deathmatch game, their archers are highly above average. Yes, they do miss hand cannoneer, thumbring, and Parthian tactics, but they have arbalests and longbows with amazing range, so they are among the most effective foot archers in the entire game. However, please note that just because they may have some of the best archers, this doesn't mean that these archers are as good as a top tier cavalry or siege civ. In deathmatch, you want powerful, population efficient units, and foot archers simply don't fit into this category. Their infantry is average because they miss nothing, but they have no bonuses. Their cavalry is below average because they miss paladin, hussar, and bloodlines, which makes their cavalry a lot more squishy than most civilizations. You'll still see Briton players make cavalier, but that's not because their cavalier are good, only because they simply need to make them to take out onagers and to have a somewhat population-efficient unit out on the field. In Age of Conquerors, their siege is far below average, because while they do have siege engineers, they don't have siege onager, siege ram, or heavy scorpion, which means while their onagers are fine, that's really about it. In the HD expansions, though, they got Warwolf, and more importantly, access to heavy scorpions, which can significantly help the Briton army and bumps them up two grades to being average. Now, despite the fact that they have some of the best archers in the game, you may be surprised to learn how much a few scorpions can do to protect your army. Despite this, their siege is still not as good as many other civilizations, lacking both siege onager and siege ram, but they are better than it was in Age of Conquerors. The Briton defenses are below average. Now, this may sound very surprising, because they only miss Bombard Tower and Treadmill Crane from the university, and they have some pretty sweet ranged units. However, I view defenses in the context of a real game, and in a game, missing Treadmill Crane means they are very slow. While they do have long-ranged units, you can't really use them at the start of a game, and because you miss paladins and camels, there's a good chance you could get overwhelmed early by a good rush civilization. In fact, the only reason they're not ranked bottom tier is because once they do get started, the longbows can be hard to deal with. However, in all honesty, I would still much rather have siege onagers for defending hills. When you look at their tech tree, I think that they were designed to be overwhelmingly reliant on archers, with a few units in between to kind of help them out. However, in deathmatch, archers are simply the least effective units you can choose, even if you're using the Briton archers. And as such, because they miss a bunch of other techs, I think you can start to see why they're not going to be that strong. And so, let's talk about deathmatch strategy for the Britons. To start off, when you look at their early game, it is simply one of the weakest in the entire game. They have no treadmill crane, they have no elephants, and they have subpar cavalry. This means you're probably going to be defending early. It also means that it's unlikely that you'll be setting the stage of the game unless you are significantly better than your opponent, and in that situation it really doesn't matter what civilization you're using. As such, your build order will be reactionary most of the time, and it will vary from game to game. As such, instead of giving you a template to use for the start, and then telling you different units to make once the game has gotten rolling, I'll divide this strategy guide up, not by game phase like I normally do, but instead by the different build orders. First, the most common one is the barracks to archery range build order. At the start, immediately queue up 15 villagers, have one existing villager create a house, and the other two create separate barracks. Send your scout to raid your opponent's space, and make sure to put it on aggressive stance. Once the fourth villager comes out, you'll place the foundations to more barracks and houses, all about one tile apart from each other. Remember, don't forget the houses. Getting housed in the early game of a deathmatch game can be a critical mistake that you definitely don't want to make. As soon as you can, create halbs from the barracks versus most civilizations, or champions versus meso-civs and the goths. Once you've placed the foundations to about 8 barrackses, place foundations for 8 archery ranges and make arbalests out of those. You would use this opening versus most of the non-archer and non-elephant civilizations, because you won't have to worry too much about your arbalests getting devastated early by onagers. And because they have all that extra range, they can still be effective support units versus the somewhat early enemy attacks. When these buildings are nearing completion, you should create 3-5 castles and 5 siege workshops at your base. If for some reason your opponent hasn't gained map control, do the workshops first and maybe delay longbow production and instead make more arbalests, while the castles could be placed forward and on hills. But be careful not to get greedy. If instead your opponent is pressuring you, try your best to keep your current units alive and get those castles out fast in order to defend your base, and hopefully amass a large army which can be used to push away your opponent. When it comes to setting up your economy for this build order, gold and wood are far more important than food because you don't really need that much food for halbs. Don't forget to make farms, of course, but it's not that big of a priority. Another build order is the barracks to siege workshop opening. This one can catch fellow archer civilizations by surprise because you get onagers out incredibly quickly, and it can be very effective versus elephant civilizations because you can get your halberdier and heavy scorpion combo rolling. Basically, this build order is the same as the previous one, except you make your siege workshops before you make archery ranges. I often do create archery ranges after the workshops though, because after all, the arbalests and skirmishers can be very useful. You'll still need infantry as a sort of meat shield early on, and remember, a few archer civs such as the Chinese and Mongols will still use cavalry, but don't underestimate how valuable rams can be. Also, this would be the preferred opening versus the Goths, and maybe versus the Mezzocivs, because you can get champions and then heavy scorpions out in order to defeat this infantry. You might later add in some arbalests or longbows to add some extra support, but versus eagles and huscarls, the heavy scorpions will do far better than archers. I know some players would say to use onagers here, but it's my experience that it's far easier to keep heavy scorpions alive. Also, keep in mind that this will only work in the HD expansions, because in Age of Conquerors you don't have heavy scorpions, and as such you'll be forced to make more onagers and archers. Regardless, if you go with champions at the start and throughout the game, you'll need more villagers on food than with the previous build order. One very interesting and somewhat risky opening is to clump. Basically, instead of building your buildings one tile apart, you create them in a circle around your town center with zero gaps. You do this if you knew that your opponents have super fast civilizations, or if you're the flank player and are afraid of getting double teamed in a team game. The advantage of this strategy is that if you do it properly, you'll save all of your villagers from enemy raids, and because you're the Britons, you have a good castle unit anyway, so it kind of fits. When you clump, generally your buildings are going to be castles and siege workshops, and maybe barracks. Make sure that when you clump, you get all the foundations started before the enemy units arrive, because otherwise, they'll be able to get inside and wreak havoc on your defenseless villagers. And this is why this strategy can be risky, because if you do it wrong, you will throw the game. Also, this strategy only really works well in a team game, because your allies can't bail you out in a 1v1, and because in 1v1s, you actually start further away than your opponent, so I don't really view it as being necessary. Anyway, get lots of halberdiers and mass longbows, and once the enemy attacks are repelled, delete a house or barracks in order to build more buildings outside the clump. If you happen to be still under pressure and you finished your buildings, you can try to move away, but make sure that you delete a house that is at the opposite end of where your opponent's units will be,
or you'll die!
Lastly, as the pocket player in a team game, I'd suggest the normal barracks to range to castles to workshop openings, because you can make tons of castles to defend your trade line, and while your ranged units aren't that great alone, they can still complement friendly siege onagers and paladins pretty well. Also, keep in mind that in a team game, using cheap archer and trash units isn't that great a use of your population space. Because of this, later in the game, you may want to add in some cavalry, especially in team games, even though they don't do that much for you in the open. Yeah, they're not the best cavalry, but they are more population efficient than infantry, and in all honesty, they deal with the inevitable siege that will be used to counter the Britons. Speaking of their counters, it's really not that hard to counter the Britons. Basically, rush them at the start to either kill them off early or to severely weaken them. If you don't execute your rush that well, in all honesty, that's fine, because many civs can simply destroy them with a better army. If you are a cavalry civ, mass up your army and then charge in, making sure not to take too much needless damage from halves, and instead kill the juicy siege and archers. Don't trickle in the units, though, because at high numbers, the longbows and arbalists can fend off a few paladins. If instead you are a siege civ, make lots of onagers and rams to destroy the archers, and add in something such as infantry or scorpions to kill the Briton melee units. If instead you are an infantry civ, use huscarls or eagles to kill the archers. If you don't have either of these units, you're either the Japanese or the Vikings, which both still have onagers and rams. And so, that's the Britons, everybody. They were a very highly requested civilization for me to do, and I suspect that this is because they are a popular one online among new players, especially in Black Forest games. However, in Deathmatch, they're simply one of the slowest civilizations in the entire game, with very few early game options. While their archer units are some of the best in the game, they're still not nearly as good as top-tier siege, cavalry, and even infantry. Remember, this is largely because they're not that population efficient. As such, they're probably a bottom 5 civilization in Deathmatch. However, this doesn't mean that they're not fun. There are few things more rewarding than destroying an army of siege onagers by microing your elite longbowmen. In my opinion, we play games to have fun, and if you enjoy the Britons, play them to your heart's content. Just don't expect to win that many Deathmatch games. Also, to end, I would like to thank some of this month's patrons, who were Jacob Pedersen, Elite Chuko Noob, Ethan Brown, Sir Lawrence NZ, and John Kumane.
JRed Age of Empires is not held liable by law for incorrect pronunciations. Please do not litigate.
If you want to get involved with the creation of my videos by having early access to my scripts in order to give suggestions before I even make a video, you can go to my Patreon page to learn more. Anyway, that's enough sellout for one video. Thanks a whole lot for watching, and I hope that you've enjoyed.